This is WKTV Journal In Focus. I'm Ken Norris. Today in Focus, we welcome back onto the show two Kent County leaders to discuss what is new, what is next, and what is important to know for the nearly 3/4 of a million residents of the county. We'll discuss the county's impressive and cooperative handling of the COVID-19 pandemic over the last year, as well as several new county facility projects moving full speed ahead despite the pandemic. And finally, the ever-evolving world of community policing by the Sheriff's Department. Stay with us. This is WKTV Journal. Today in Focus is a friend of WKTV who has been in our studio many times over the last 4 years, Kent County Administrator Wayman Britt. We first talked to him when he took the position of lead administrator in 2018. But his service to the county goes back almost 2 decades to 2004. On July 30, Mr. Britt will be leaving his service to Kent County and its nearly 700,000 residents. Today, we will talk with him about current news within county governance, about its efforts during the last year as it and everybody dealt with the pandemic, and his personal challenge of leadership in an unexpectedly difficult time. Thank you for joining us today, sir.
Thank you for having me, Ken. Good to see you again.
Good to see you. As you planned to retire, to leave your service to Kent County, you must have had a vision for how your last year might unfold. And then came the pandemic. I assume this year was different than you expected, and I'm particularly interested in how did you adapt to the challenge of leadership in this difficult time?
Without a question, it was a very unusual year. We did not expect the pandemic to go as long as it went. Then right at the front end of it, it was a tremendous amount of pressure to figure out what we're gonna do to get through it. It just threw everything off. You know, we're right in the middle of preparing for our budget. You know, each year we do that, and there were a number of projects on the table that we had to delay, and we'll talk about that hopefully in a little bit. But it really taught me how to be adaptable under crisis, and I thank God that it wasn't my first rodeo. We've had other crises back in 2007, 8, 9, when we had the big recession and other times. But this was unlike any other time, and you had to bring your A game to the table because it wasn't just about dollars and cents, it was about saving lives. And I can tell you that if it wasn't for the people that were around me at the time, we were planning, you know, from all of the elected officials that were involved and the staff. I have a tremendously talented staff. And if it wasn't for them, there's no way that we would have gotten through it. So I owe it all to the staff and all the other partners, the friends that we have in the community that came together. It was a team effort in the community. It wasn't just what I did, but I just believe that we got through it because of the quality of people that we have in our community.
Very good. We're going to go a little more in depth in that in a minute. Your office recently issued an annual report focused on the last year and the county's response to the COVID pandemic, and it was titled, and I quote, "A Year of Crisis and Community Collaboration." I know that the Kent County Health Department, led by Dr. London, who was in here several times, has been at the forefront of the county's response. But I guess you brought up just briefly, how did the county collaborate with other local and regional partners? Give us some examples of that collaboration
It was truly a regional collaboration. Other counties, other municipalities, our townships, our cities, and then our departments. Within our departments, we have 25 departments elected and non-elected departments. And truly, they were the heroes. With our sheriff's office, we've had opportunity to talk with sheriff over the last year and so forth on the show, in fact. But there were others. The juvenile detention center, where we had to deal with the number of youth that were in that location, making sure that they were safe. Stacy McGinnis and her team were tremendous in how they responded to the COVID-19. We did have a few early scares. Our court system, our judgeship, how they responded with us, worked with us, very quick to identify ways to continue to hold sessions in court, and the tremendous amount of responsibility that the whole entire community, from our business community, our philanthropic community, number of corporations, Steelcase, Meyer, and Mike Jandanoa, a good friend of mine, reached out when it first hit. Wayman, what do we got to do? And I can name other ones, John Kennedy, Fred Keller, these people who reached out to me. And we were very receptive to their help and to their pull. And we pulled together many in the community. When we had the first notion that we were going to go back to work, we pulled together the business community and made that happen. I can't thank my board of commissioners enough for allowing me to lead, give me the ability to make decisions in a quick fashion. They trusted my leadership. And my wife Dinah, tremendous too, because I was there every day. And every weekend we were on point. So, you know, she and my dog Britta, they were right there all along.
Whenever you came home and needed a smiling face,
need a little encouragement.
Yeah. There you go. Before we get off of the COVID year, I wanted to, I found it striking that a lot of the federal funds that flowed into the area were, I don't know what the term might be, that the county was the conduit for that. The money flowed in, the money flowed out.
Yeah.
But there was always very deliberate committees, discussions, whether it was the chamber. I would consider that to be a huge compliment for the county, that the county was trusted with the flowing of whatever it was, $150 million or whatever.
Yeah, we took a different approach. Instead of it being an internal rescue plan, if you will, internal effort to remedy problems, we reached out to the broader community and brought the partners inside with us, and we tag teamed this. And like you say, there were several committee meetings pre deciding to move in with the Chamber of Grand Rapids, with the United Way. And the lesson learned from all of this is that there's so much more intellectual power beyond the county walls. You got to bring that help in and support in. But I'm so thankful that we didn't resist the notion that sometimes people try to contain it, and we listened to the community and said, how can we help to remedy this problem? And if we hadn't done that, I don't think we'd been able to come out of it as well as we did. I mean, we did this different than most counties. Most counties did not take the time and effort that we went through to identify, working with the community, how we would go about doing this. And so that's a unique experience. We've always been good at collaboration in the community, but this was like a real pivotal moment in time where we took the lessons learned and figured out how do we work together with community to make that happen. And I'm very pleased with what happened.
Very good. Okay. Want to move on to a couple of other subjects. As all-consuming as the county's pandemic response has been, in some ways it was business as usual for the county and for everybody. Early last year, Kent County Commissioners approved an expenditure of almost $19 million for three capital improvement projects. North County Campus, a permanent Parks and Recreation Department office out at Millennium Park, and an expanded vehicle repair maintenance facility. What is the status of those, given whatever problems the pandemic may have caused?
We stalled those projects not knowing where things were going to lead. And we said, let's look at it every couple of months or so. And so we got consensus that we would move ahead, recognizing that these projects had been laid since the first crisis, the first recession back in 2005, 6, 7. We stalled those projects. And at some point, we're going to come out of this. So now, yes, we have the Parks Administration Building. They have been living, working in trailers.
That's what I understood.
Not a good setup for them and for those that would visit. So that is a pivotal project. That project is well underway. By December this year, they should be ready to move into that facility. So they've already broken ground. Things are already happening. That's already moving forward. The North County facility is underway as well. We've let out our architectural plans. We are now looking at bringing in the general contractor and the subcontractors and letting all of that out, being bid. And then December of 2022, we expect that facility to be completed as well.
Very good.
And then the next one is the fleet services building you talked about, mm-hmm. where we do all the maintenance of our facilities. That project is now moving forward with design work, and then by December of next year as well, 2022, that facility should be complete.
Very good.
So we're well on our way to get all three of those projects done.
Very good. Okay, we're going to take just a pause to allow Mr. Britt. Why don't you take your tissue paper and put particularly, I think, right around your nose here.
I
want to make sure you look good. It is warm, and
it's warm.
Like I said, I apologize for that, but we're going to get this thing done today.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
So I'm going to pick up with a question. You can come to me on the one shot, and here we go. Over the last year, there were also two hires by Kent County for major leadership roles, actually an outside hire and an inside promotion. Jennifer Kimball James as Deputy County Administrator, and Teresa Branson as the county's first Chief Inclusion Officer. I want you to tell me both the importance of these positions, but also do you see an importance that both of them are women being placed in leadership roles?
Yes. The position of Deputy County Administrator is a position that's sorely needed. If something happens to the administrator, then what? We are now, like you said earlier, 700,000 populous county and $500 million in revenue. Serious pull from the community about what can Kent County do to drive the economy and to improve the conditions of our community. We need more stamina, intelligence, the human ability to be able to communicate, and so definitely we needed another person. It was just way too much for me to manage. Mm-hmm. And luckily we were able to recruit Jennifer Kimball James. I went to Rockville, Maryland. Instead of doing the interview just here, I went down to see her because I felt so strong about her ability and her talent and didn't want her to get off the hook. So I showed up there and we had lunch and I asked her right there, I says, "Are you ready to come to Kent County?" And she says, "Yep, I'm ready." I said, "You sure?" "Yep, I'm sure." And what a great move that was. It was one of the best decisions I've ever made. She is intelligent. She cares about people. She's a great communicator. And man, when I leave, I can feel like a little bit of me is left there, how I operate, how I think. So very, very thankful for that. And then Teresa Branson, the new Chief Inclusion Officer for the county. Teresa's been with county for 24 years. She's well known in our community, respected, credible individual from multiple community groups and our Board of Commissioners. I have not heard one negative complaint about her hire, and she will bring talent, intelligence to this job. She will do things that we've never seen before. Kent County will grow up under her. She's got great passion and energy, and just a wonderful person. As I was leaving the office today, people were greeting her. It was just wonderful to see how she interacts. And she makes everyone, no matter your color, skin color, your background.
Right.
She's gonna be great for us.
The term inclusion, a lot of people, a lot of organizations, a lot of businesses talk inclusion. Seems to me that Kent County put some money behind that commitment.
We put some money behind it. We put some research behind it. We understand what it is and what it means, and it's very, very important that we identify how do we increase the number of people in our community that are empowered, that are engaged in making our community a better place to live and work. And that's inside the county and then outside the citizenry of our county. How can we do that? How can we lift the ability of this community? Key position. And at the end of the day, taxpayers are going to say, wow, what a wonderful place this is, because we've taken the time to research and understand what inclusion really means.
Very good. As we near the end of this interview, the first time that we met and talked in 2018, I asked a kind of a cliche question about your basketball history, your background, and what that meant in business. But now that we have some history, I think I asked the wrong question. I think instead of your playmaking ability, it's your coaching ability that has come in to play over the last few years. Have you, like a good basketball coach, prepared your team to succeed and then now just
absolutely
go out and play?
Every day, and now more than ever, I am coaching them. I am pushing them to be coaches as well. They know what we expect, how we expect them to lead. They understand what leadership is. We've done numerous book studies and leadership conferences and trainings and discussions and weekly meetings, one-on-one meetings, staff meetings, executive staff meetings, just to make sure they get it and that they're confident. They're ready to go. We've got one of the best teams in America in Kent County. They understand what leadership is. They understand how to get it done, how to be effective, how to treat people the right way. And I'm happy. I can leave with joy in my heart knowing that, you know, they are ready to step into that gap.
Very good. Finally, I have to ask anybody that's moving on from position and retiring, I have to ask, what's next for Wayman Britt?
Well, I'm going to spend a lot more time with my wife. We're going to be traveling. that's the first thing. So we're going to take a trip, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, maybe 4 weeks.
There you go. I mean, you got time
right
now.
Right after I leave the county. But I'm going to spend more time with my daughters, my sons, my grandkids. And, you know, I'm going to do some writing. I'm writing a book right now.
Excellent.
That'll hopefully be released at the end of the year. And that's my goal. And from there, how can I help the community? I've got a huge project that I've been planning, working with. We're going to be starting the Fulfilling the Dream Open, the Celebrity Open, at Egypt Valley Country Club this year. And we're going to bring the community out. We're going to celebrate diversity and inclusion and ensure that this community recognizes how important our young people are. And what can we do to embody them with the same type of leadership that you display? That I display, how can we grow them in to take our place, the next generation? And I think we do that by modeling the behavior that we want them to see. So we're going to have a great time in September. Looking forward to that. So that's a major project for me. And then I will serve on numerous boards. I serve on Trinity Health Michigan board. I serve on the Right Place board, the President Ford Foundation board, and several others. So I will continue to serve, and then I may do some speaking, consulting. I've been asked to do some of that already.
Mm-hmm.
So we'll see how that all plays out, and then we'll see what the good Lord says beyond that.
Very good. And I started this conversation by saying you were a friend of WKTV, and God willing, this will be not the last time that you're sitting in that seat, only you'll have a different title maybe the next time that we talk.
Looking forward to it, Ken.
Very good.
God bless you.
Thank you. This has been WKTV Journal In Focus. I'm Ken Norris. Thanks to our guest, and thanks to you for joining us. For more WKTV news and video interviews, check out WKTVjournal.org and WKTV videos on YouTube.
Hi, I'm Jessica Ann Tyson. Thanks for watching WKTV Journal right here on YouTube. Make sure you subscribe and click the bell to receive notifications every time we post new videos on the community news that's important where you live. Thank you.